Hi everybody and welcome to Professional Beauty and Hairdressers Journal Ireland's webinar for this week. And this week we're joined by Valerie Finnegan Cahill, who owns Icon Hair Design in Cork. Hi Val, nice to see you. And Val is going to be talking to us about, well, the topic that we chose was back to business, thriving in the new normal. So we'll just go straight ahead and into our Q&A there, Val. I have been saying to you, it's just over 2 weeks since reopening. So reopening was Monday the 29th. It actually feels like longer. Probably.
I know.
Yeah. So, like, from, say, since the 29th to now and ongoing for the moment, how are you dealing or how have you dealt with the backlog of appointments in a way that ensures the health and safety, the new protocols that are in place, but that you're still meeting demand, and I suppose at the same time as well maintaining, you know, your own profitable business?
Wow, that's a big chunk.
Don't take your time with this.
Okay. Well, I suppose realistically, very early on when COVID came, we started. Zoom chats with the team, and we started discussing kind of like how we would move forward through COVID, and then all of those things started to pop up. Do you know what I mean? When we did open, how are we going to manage our clientele? And one of the things that one of the lads said was like, it's like lining up your children in front of you and asking the mother to pick her favorite child. Do you know what I mean? And that was the start then of how we were going to manage reopening for the clients. So we came up with an idea that we would develop a waiting list. So we had that then in a three-phase system. So the first phase we decided was going to be our over 70s clients, because we did feel that they had such a hard time during this with cocooning and everything. And we felt it would be nice to give something back to them. So the first phase of clients that we brought in were the over 70s and the at risk. Okay. Then we took back anybody who had appointments booked in with us that were cancelled because of COVID. And then it was everybody else then after that. But when we decided that as a group, we then needed to go to the IT people, because what we did was, in order to protect our business, we looked for deposits. So in order to go on the wait list, you had to give a deposit. And it was one price for just cuts and then another one for a cut and color. So that kind of like secured your place, but it also gave our business a little bit of a softer landing coming into COVID. Also on a kind of we're very strong on values in the salon, and it was very in line with the ethos of the salon. And our clients really appreciated the fact that we took the time to actually organize the list like that. And they felt that it was a very fair way of organizing it. And it wasn't going to be a free for all, because I think during this period of time, there's enough uncertainty. And that would give me anxiety. Do you know what I mean? Thinking, where am I going to be? Why doesn't she pick me? Or why has my friend got an appointment and I don't have an appointment? And it's just insane. Like the language that I'm hearing all the time now around people getting appointments, people not getting appointments, it's actually big news at the moment. It's nearly like a boast. I'm in restaurants. Oh, really? He hasn't contacted you yet? I was in a week ago. I mean, it's insane. But look, for us, we felt that was the fairest way. It also, as I said, gave us income. And it stopped people from, I'm not saying that they would have, because our clients are really, really good. But look, somebody could have just said, you're a new salon, I'd love to try you out, I'll stick my name down there. And then they could have got an appointment a week earlier somewhere else. And then we would have been high and dry. Whereas having the deposit attached to the appointment kind of, you know, it's secured. It secured your place and it's secured, you know, our appointment as well.
Yeah.
So that's how we did the waiting list. And it was a really, it was really professionally done. There was a link, they went in, we got their details, their emails, and the phase. And then what they wanted done, who they wanted to go to. And before, like the week before we opened, we were able to categorize then everything. Do you know what I mean? So it started with the phases, then it went to the stylists. So at the end of it, we had first phase, then broken down into who they wanted to go to. And then we were able to start ringing them and booking them in. So it was very, very organized.
Yeah. And you know, when you said there earlier on about, you know, one for cut and one for cut and color, I can't remember how you phrased it. Did you limit the services that you were providing at the very start, or did you just, could people come back and have anything they wanted done?
No, we were not doing blow dries. Okay. So we're not doing blow dries. We're not doing dry styling. We're not doing up styling.
Okay.
So anything like that. And we decided not to do that for the simple reason is based on capacity levels, and they're more of an indulgence. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, like, they're not essential.
You know, they're not essential.
Yeah.
You know? I know it's lovely to get your hair blow dried, but you know, we're not going to put that in front of somebody who needs a haircut or who needs their color done. So
yeah.
We're not saying that we're not going to do them, but they're pushed out.
Yeah. Okay. And so do you think, you know, after mentioning all that stuff around how you communicated and stuff, is customer care and customer service, do you think that's more important now than ever before?
I mean, it is just, it's critical. It's actually critical. During COVID, we were very, very, very active on all our social media platforms. And we were very aware as well that there were clients of ours that weren't on social media.
Yeah.
And it's gas, because the amount of our clients who are now on social media, who weren't on social media, because they've been told, did you hear Val? Did you hear what they're saying? No. I need to get on. So a lot of our clients now have shifted onto social media. But for those who weren't on social media, we rang them. Like we rang all of, I would like to say all, but maybe there was a few that slipped through the cracks. But we rang our older clientele to see how they were. We just checked in, because Some of our clients are widows. They're cocooning. We don't know, has anybody been out to them? Do they need anything? So we did that while we were closed. And then we text everyone and we let them know. So for us, with our team, 4 times a week, we would do a Zoom every single week. 2 were team meetings and 2 were training sessions. And then for our clients, we were constantly on Instagram and Facebook on stories, telling them, giving them the information, bringing both along at the same time. Do you know what I mean? Because, you know, I think for a lot of what was going on during COVID, silence was probably the toughest of all the things. Do you know what I mean? You know, and that's, I think, what was creating a lot of anxiety. And from the second week in, when we had our team meeting, my lads were like, I'm terrified. Do you know what I mean? I don't know what to, like, and you need to actually voice these things, you know? Mm-hmm. And then once they're out, once they're on the table, you can start figuring out a way of, you know, getting through it.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you're stuck. Our clients. So once, as a team, we always had, okay, what's next? Where are we going? What are we doing? What's down the line? What's the next thing? Because there was so much to try and get your head around, mm-hmm. that it was overwhelming, and trying to do all of that in your own head was driving everyone crazy, particularly me. If I hadn't the team, and if I hadn't the team to bounce ideas off of and figure out a roadmap out of this,
yeah,
I would have been lost. And because we were able to do that, then we were able to create a roadmap for our clients. And we were meticulous then. And customer, like, customer care is now, like, I suppose safety is now the new luxury. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, people, when our clients are coming into us, before our clients came in, we had gone through the whole customer journey step by step. We made up a COVID response manual for the salon. We did SOPs, which I never knew like what an SOP was until COVID. Like, we have a standard operating procedure around everything. We have a glass door. We put a bell on the door. The door is always locked. And it's step by step. What happens? What happens prior to their booking, to their appointment? Do you know what I mean? We sent out, so through emails, telling them exactly what the customer journey was going to be like, then putting up imagery on Instagram and Facebook, making up, every customer we have has a customer care package.
Right.
So like, for me, it was about getting the roadmap and then giving them the information, right? So the minute our client comes in, as I said, every movement is managed, but they're sat in the waiting area. And then the whole thing is explained to them.
Yeah.
They're given their package, or they're shown their package. What the contents of the package is explained to them. We go through everything with them then. And then once that's done, then it's back to business. It's back to being normal. Do you know what I mean? And the sense of relief that's attached to that for the client, knowing that their experience is 100% managed and it's managed safely, they completely forget then about COVID. Do you know what I mean? Because they know. It's, people are afraid of doing the wrong thing, and that's what scares them. And if they're told, this is what's happening, this is how you do it, this is how we're going to do it together, and then we get going, then that's perfect. It's clear communication, and that's customer service.
Yeah.
For me. Like, everything else is a given. It's what we've been always doing. It's just great service. But the other stuff, and it's having that plan and having a procedure around it. It's literally like you're just protecting the client to an extent that they can actually relax and enjoy the experience because we've taken care of it.
And was it, what was it like actually, we kind of touched on this when we were talking among ourselves, you know, the way we were saying, like, it's one thing to have a plan, but when you put the plan into action, say on the 29th, how was that? And how has that been going since?
I actually didn't sleep the night before the 29th. I swear to God, I watched every hour on the clock. I went through every single thing because we had put in all these SOPs around everything.
Yeah.
I was like, oh my God, I was really overwhelmed. And then, so Karina, some things worked beautifully and others didn't.
Yeah.
So like that manual that we have in the SOPs, it's a moving piece, it's a body of work, but it's moving and it's evolving all of the time. And sometimes we go, no, that didn't work, but if we do this, that'll work better.
Yeah.
And that's all you can do, because there is no like manual previously to this. So you literally, you know, you go, okay, that was okay, but you know what? It's better if we do this. Like, for example, our customer care package. So I'm driven demented by what this is doing to the environment. I was like, when it happened, I was like, oh God, at least now there's something kind of good coming out of this.
Yeah.
And then with all of the other stuff, the PPE, the disposable gowns, I'm like having a little bit of a nightmare about it. So like, we have garment covers, you know? So in our package, we have masks, gowns. We work between disposable towels and cloth towels.
Okay.
Because of the amount of laundering that we have to do. So in just for example, in the care package, we have paper bag, with, and it's we have the icon sticker on it, so they know that like it hasn't been opened, it hasn't been touched. Yeah. Two disposable towels, disposable gown. There's a garment cover for everything. So if you have your jacket, your bag, we ask you to take out anything that you need, like your phone, whatever, we sanitize that. And then everything that you're not bringing with you, we tend to kind of like ask you not to bring too much onto the section.
Yeah.
So whatever's left, we cover it completely. Okay. So it doesn't touch off of anything else in the closet.
Yeah.
Right? But my God, the material that's left at the end of the day between the bag, So
yeah.
Now we ask our clients, we say, look, this is your care package. The only thing we ask of you is that you take your belongings home with you and you put it into your recycling bag. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So that's it. But like, we never even thought of that when we were doing this. You know? So yeah, and it's informing the clients as well. Like what we say to them is, look, this is your package. But like, when you do dispose of it, you have to double bag it and wait 72 hours to dispose of it. And they're going, really? And I'm going, yes, you do. And they're like, oh my God. But that kind of knowledge and sharing that kind of information, they're going, oh, I'm
getting that. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, any PPE, it has to be double bagged in 72 hours. And they're like, oh my God. And I'm saying, yes, I have done 5 2-hour webinars on health and safety, so I don't know these things. Ah! Yeah, so look, it's all learning, it's all new, it's all, yeah.
All a learning curve, yeah. And then about like in terms of client retention, because obviously that's very important. How are you continuing to communicate with them as the business adapts, you know, to the new normal? And is that ongoing on social media?
Yeah. Well, for the client retention, our clientele they're really good for rebooking.
Yeah.
And I think I think the most important thing for businesses right now, for hair salons right now and beauty salons, it's another critical. You have to rebook your clients.
Yeah.
To be honest with you, the environment is ready. Like the clients are ready. They're primed now to rebook because they've been waiting so long for this appointment. They don't want to wait. They want to ensure that they have their next one. But if it's not managed, they will forget.
Mm-hmm.
So it has to be managed. And that is the only way that you can forecast going forward. Do you know what I mean? Like I'm looking at the business now and we have another probably steady 2 weeks solid of 13-hour days, 6 days a week.
Yeah.
Right? But after the 2 weeks, the volume will have dropped, you know? So now we're starting to go on social media, you know, we're putting it out there that it's a new salon. Do you know what I mean? We're trying to make people aware of us.
Mm-hmm.
To get new clients, because right now I think salon owners, like, because I was there myself, I'm like, oh Jesus, let me just get through what I have. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But you have to expand. You have to be ready to take on new clients, because that lower drop, that's the scary bit. Do you know what I mean? Like, do I go on to a 4-day week with the team? Can we extend? Do you know what I mean? Can we keep it going for 6 days, 13 hours? I'm not sure. You know, so it's really, I think rebooking is probably the most important thing. And then getting active on social, trying to get new clients in, doing competitions, whatever it takes. But you've got to move. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, you've got to keep on top of it all the time. Yeah. And just there around, you were saying about the 13-hour days and the open 6 days a week. And I know we talked about that. Like, how are you managing the staff rosters and meeting their needs and expectations? And as well as all that, I suppose, in the middle of it all, maintaining staff morale. Now, it sounds like you really did that during the lockdown anyway, when you had your Zoom meetings every week. You never lost, you know, lost touch with each other. But, you know, in obviously, this is a very busy period now. So managing all that and kind of, for the want of a better expression, keeping everyone happy.
Yeah. Okay, so what we do at the moment is we have 8 on... we've 8 on the team in Icon, and we're split into 2 different teams. So our week looks like, so if I work Monday, Tuesday, I work Monday, Tuesday, Friday, okay? Mm-hmm. And the following week, I will then work Wednesday, Thursday, Saturday. So the week is full all the time. And then the next week, then we actually, I'll do the other shift. So, you know, about every second week, I have beautiful 4 days off.
Right.
So actually love this. Now, the days that we are in are hard. And I mean, Christ's sake, I'm 52. I'm nearly dead at the end of the third 13-hour full thing. Do you know? But thankfully, I have lots of stamina and energy. And I'm sure they're going to go, oh, my God, if she can do it, do you know? With the teams, when we finish our shift, we do a kind of a, like, particularly on the first week, this was really important. So we worked the Monday and the Tuesday. My team went in first. And really, it was like going into space.
Mm.
You know, none of us, we had no idea how it was going to work. Was it going to work? All the work we'd done, no idea. So on the Tuesday night then, we had arranged a Zoom kind of like handover.
Yeah.
And it was fabulous because everything that worked fabulously for us, we were able to tell the lads. Mm-hmm. And everything that we kind of went, oh no, that didn't go too well. Or, you know, we didn't actually even think about that. So now we were able to tell that to the lads and share that with them. And they were delighted. We only spoke about it yesterday that, like, we loved the connection through Zoom. That really all we have now is Sundays where we can all kind of get together on Zoom. So mm-hmm. we're working on organizing a team Zoom that way.
Okay.
But I'm forever onto the lads, maybe a bit more than what they want. Realistically, I suppose the best thing that did come out of COVID for us was we really got together as a team. You know, like, I got the lads to come in separately. They got mannequin heads, stands. I did 5 different technical haircuts with them. You know, they were cutting in their bathrooms, in their kitchens. You know, the other stylists did blow dry training with the apprentice, and Maria done color training with all of us, theory. And it just, it kind of empowered all of us that we all had something to give.
Yeah.
And really, like, as I said, there was so much organizing to do that the lads were all part of that. Do you know what I mean? It was their roadmap, do you know? And it wasn't me telling them. And because they made it with me, there was very little fear of going in. Yeah. So as far as motivating the lads, you know, they're back doing what they love.
Yeah.
And they're busy, but for me, as probably a leader for them, I now need to look ahead and see, okay, where do we need to be going from here? Do you know what I mean? How can I organize motivating them? You know, and that will be on Sundays. They'll be delighted.
It's not as if, like, even there when you said about, like, how you went back, your team went back in on the Monday and Tuesday, and then you did the handover, like, immediately when you said about doing the handover, I visualized you all meeting for a drink, and then I was like, but sure, you can't do that. No. You have to go on Zoom.
No, I have to say, my team had champagne in their hands while all the rest of them were in their bedrooms.
Yeah, but you know the way, it's like, it's all the stuff that you would have done before as a team, you know, like stuff in the evening and everybody gone for a drink together, whatever, that's all, you know, on hold for the moment.
Exactly.
And just in, like, around the that rostering schedule that you've got going on now, I suppose, like, we none of us have any way of knowing how long we're going to be in this, you know, situation for. So I know you mentioned to me that, like, one of the things that sort of has been cropping up in this new normal would be HR issues, like, you know, like, have you had to do things around people's contracts? Or, you know, have you any tips around things like that?
To be honest with you, the HR side of it, I'm not great on. I give everything to Tommy.
Right.
HR guy. I suppose because we're just into it now, I do have a meeting organized with him Monday week, I think. Because he said, look, Val, he said, you need to see, there's no point in kind of like putting measurements around stuff when it's not going to be a permanent situation. Yeah. I have sat with the lads and they're happy to work along with the rosters.
Yeah.
Until we know more. But for me, like I only got on to Emma today and I said, look, I said, you need to roster out as, you know what I mean, right out to December. But when you're explaining to people that are making their bookings, it could change. But there has to be some kind of a structure around the business.
Yeah.
You know, like once the team, once the communication is there with the team and they're happy, they're not, like I haven't changed the contracts. I actually, when we started on the ships, I did give them, it was like an... a roster to say that this is because due to COVID, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
Are you happy? You've got to, like, you have to document everything. Do you know what I mean? So your shifts will be from here until we know more.
Yeah.
And they'll have to sign it. So yeah. I think it's very important to kind of like, you know, you need to not cover your back, but things need to be documented right now, my hair.
Yeah, of course, because we're, you know, we're all in a very unknown zone.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, just I think for people's working weeks and I don't know the expression terms and conditions going forward. Yeah. So you think it's just something that you kind of have to constantly keep an eye on for the moment until we get more secure.
I think it's like that COVID manual. Do you know what I mean? It's a moving part.
Yeah.
So I think, and I suppose for me, because there is constant communication with the team, they would let me know if they weren't happy. And thankfully that is the situation I have with my team. Not everybody would be the same. So maybe there would be a salon that would need, do you know what I mean? Nearly a HR department. Thankfully.
Yeah. Actually, do you think in general there's a situation maybe cropping up that some salons are like they're looking for staff now because they're losing staff because staff that they had don't want to work. Yeah. I've personally seen quite a few ads cropping up on social media for salons just around, not necessarily in Cork or anything, just around the country. Yeah. I've seen quite a few jobs advertised. Do you think that's becoming a thing?
Yeah, so there will be two things really that I would see causing this is cause and effect, really. There was a number of hairdressers who would have still been working during COVID.
Mm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And their clients would have been clients of a salon.
Yeah.
And now it seems it could be more lucrative or it seems a better option for them now not to go back into the salon and to do Nixers instead.
Yeah. Yeah.
Unfortunately, and it will, I just think it'll just take our industry to a place that just isn't good.
Yeah, not good.
You know, my personal opinion on it is it's shocking. It was irresponsible to be doing it during COVID. And, you know, I mean, going on the black market, like it just, it's crazy as far as I'm concerned. So that's the first thing. So I have heard of salons unable to open back up because they have no staff.
Okay.
Which is shocking.
Yeah.
The other thing would be because of the if a salon is splitting their shift, splitting their teams, and doing a double shift, they would need more stylists to cover the hours.
Okay.
Because we're talking about going from, you know, a 39-hour week, but then you're doubling that up.
Yeah.
You know, so you would need more staff for that. So I think it's like a dovetail. You know, there's the black market, unfortunately, and there's the extended hours.
Okay. All right then, and I suppose finally, I'm just going to ask you. You've probably touched a little bit on it already. I think you said there that we're kind of a little bit over 2 weeks in, and you've got probably another 2 weeks of clearing the backlog or, you know, being super busy. So so that was always going to be busy. And as we've said as well, the hair and beauty industry got such attention from the media during lockdown.
Who'd have thought, huh?
Yeah, it was like, you know, everybody was so thrilled that everything was reopening. So this particular period that we're in at the moment was always going to be really full on. But like, that's obviously going to taper off a little bit. So for yourself, and what would you say to other salon owners about like just continuing to build the momentum going forward and building up your business even more? And also kind of like capitalizing, if that's the correct word, on like how valued the industry became during lockdown, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, that everybody suddenly realized that, you know, their hairdresser or their beautician was one of the most important people in their lives.
I know.
To kind of build on that going forward, like just for yourself, even how you're going to just keep building on your own business between now and whenever in the future.
Well, I suppose for me, like it's for building, we touched on it a while ago. It is about, you know, marketing it correctly and all of that. But I think during this time, yes, who'd have thought that we would be the most wanted and the most needed service? But now it's really a time to shine.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and I think that it's very easy to separate out kind of like those who are giving exceptional customer service. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. You know, because customer service is about communication. And what I would say to anybody out there is, you know, get out in front of your customer, you know, and be real while you're doing it. That was the one thing I found during COVID. Like Instagram and Facebook frightened the living daylights out of me when I had to talk.
Mm-hmm.
Now it doesn't bother me. And people want to connect, and they want to connect with your business. And they can only do that if it's real, you know? So I think now is a time not to be quiet. It's to be out there, tell people what you're doing, be very clear about it, and be very clear about how you're managing the client's experience. You'd be surprised how that would actually build your business.
Mm-hmm.
Because people are now very, very, what could I say? They're quite particular about where they go, you know?
Yeah.
So if you are saying, this is what we're going to do, this is how we're going to do it, that's already putting you in front of them. Do you know what I mean? Am I making sense? I
hope. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
I do think that is probably the most important thing at the moment. Obviously, giving the service, but to be honest with you, Karina, the service has always been there.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? And it's always been a professional service, and you know, you now need to back that up with safety.
Yeah.
And as I said, safety is now the new luxury.
Yeah, and it's like you need to display at all times that you're providing, I suppose, the Rolls Royce of safety.
Exactly. Yeah. You know, and I think a lot of the time we take it as a given, but it's not. It's actually, and I'm not saying it's a marketing thing, but it is a marketing. Like I'm saying, it's not.
Yeah.
But it is something to be marketed, because you've got to find out what your customers want and give it to them.
Yeah.
Your customer right now wants to be safe.
Yeah.
And they want that more than
their magazine or their coffee or the things that you used to give them before.
Exactly. And it's to get on top of that and really own it and take the fear out of it. Like people, they don't want to make mistakes. Tell them how it's going to go.
Yeah.
Show them that you're going to manage it.
Yeah. Okay, then. That was all extremely informative. Thank you so much for joining us. And thank you everybody else for joining us. And obviously we wish you the best of luck in the next while with the getting through the backlog. And, starting all over again, but I suppose getting the next group of people in who are coming back in.
Yeah, it's going to be very interesting, actually, the next couple of months.
Yeah. It's like you'll be getting people coming in that, like, they won't have a four-month...
regrowth.
I was going to say regrowth. Well, yeah, regrowth or whatever happened to their hair in 4 months. Lisa, you'll be seeing improved heads in front of you.
Yes.
Thank you for joining us, and thank you everybody else. And we will be back at the same time next week. We will be talking to Sheehan Sharkey. I thought I was going to get tongue-tied saying her name. She's a freelance hairstylist, so we'll be talking to her about her freelance career. So until then, thank you, and thank you so much, Val, again, and we'll talk to you soon.
Not at all.
Bye.
Take care. Bye.